What is going on, everybody? It's your boy Malik at Malik's Water Garden, and welcome back to the channel. If you're joining me today, we're gonna actually talk about something that's very important to most fish keepers, and that is how we can minimize the losses of fish in our fish room. Fish do occasionally die. This is a natural occurrence, and there is no real control over this. As far as human beings, we don't have control over death. Having said that, recently I lost four of my praecox rainbows. I had two males and two females. I was actually planning to breed them. They weren't that old. They were about a year and a half old. I've had them for about a year now. I've been growing them out, actually, and they were spawning in the tank that they were in. I was planning to move them into a new tank in the last couple of days, and I actually found them dead 2 days ago. When I walked through the aquarium, I found two of them dead. One was actually dying, and one was okay at the time, but it was gasping for air for some reason, so I moved it to another tank in which it died. All the other fish in the tank are fine. I check all the water parameters, they're all fine. I even did a 50% water change just to make sure. The nitrates in that tank are actually close to zero because I have my breeding L199 group in there, as well as my CW027 group. So like every other fish in the tank is completely fine. There's nothing wrong with the tank and or the parameters or anything else. So I don't know what killed my four praecox rainbows. I have no explanation about this. And in my 37 plus years of fish keeping, this doesn't happen that often, but it still does happen to me as well. So having said that, we're going to look at some of the things we can do ourselves as fish keepers to minimize losses in our fish rooms and our fish tanks, and to stop untimely deaths from happening. So that's the video today. And if you haven't subscribed to the channel, please subscribe and hit that notification icon down below, because I'm going to make a whole series of videos on general fish tank care and maintenance, as well as videos like this where I will be giving you knowledge that I have accumulated in my 3.5+ decades of fish keeping for you to become successful in your fish keeping endeavors and breeding as well. So there's a whole bunch of different videos, and if you haven't checked out the other videos in the channel, I highly recommend you check those out. There's a new video that just came out about angelfish. I'm going to make a video about angelfish breeding that's coming out, a whole bunch of videos about pleco breeding, about hypancestors, zebra plecos, super red plecos, bristlenose, all kinds of different stuff. So if you have anything particular, you can also comment below and let me know, and I will gladly oblige and make those videos for you. So without further ado, let's talk about some of the things we can do as fish keepers to minimize losses in our fish room. One of the main things I fully believe is we can do before we even buy our fish is to research on what type of fish we're getting. The more knowledge you have on the particular fish you have, the more successful you are going to be at providing it with adequate housing, care, food, and all that requirements. So the more knowledge you have on the particular fish that you're gonna get, the better it is for you as well as the fish. So having done your research is gonna by far minimize your losses to a large degree, because you're not gonna bring something that you do not know how to take care of. So do your research before you pick up your fish. I think that's tip number one, and that's probably one of the most important tips that I can give you guys, is to find out as much information as you can. There are some fish that there is not a lot of information about. In those cases, you can also find out general information about the genus or the family that that fish belongs to. For example, if there's a particular type of hypancestrus you want to get, and there's not a lot of information about that particular type of hypancestrus, find out information about other types of hypancestrus, because a lot of them have similar care and feeding and maintenance requirements in terms of temperature. A lot of things are pretty similar. So if you have more information about the other types of fish that does have information on, you will be more prepared to take care of the particular fish you're bringing home. So that's tip number one. And tip number two, I believe, is to have a dedicated fish store or stores, mom and pop or independently owned local fish store or stores that you can go and pick up your fish from. And as well as being a member of a local fish club, if you don't have a lot of different fish stores available, so you have access to local breeders and whatnot, and fish that are bred locally as well. And why do I say deal with an independently owned mom and pop type of store, a local fish store? The reason for that is because you are going to get a lot better customer service and a wealth of knowledge by the person usually owning the pet store. For example, I deal with several different pet stores here in Toronto. I sell fish to them as well as I buy fish from them. And a lot of these stores, the managers are very knowledgeable, so they can give you a lot of information on the fish you're getting. They can also special order fish for you. For example, if I go to Tails and Scales or Menagerie, the manager will be able to tell me what type of animal I'm getting, what type of care it requires. They're not just trying to sell you an animal and an enclosure. They're actually enthusiasts and hobbyists themselves. So they're gonna give you a more value for your money, and they're not gonna sell you something that you are not gonna be capable of taking care of. They're gonna check to make sure that you are gonna be actually successful at what you're taking home to take care of. They're not just selling things so that you come back, buy more stuff. That's not how these shops operate compared to big box stores, which seem to not care about the animals that they sell, not in terms of any malicious intent or anything, just because it's a big box store. They're just going through stock. It's a stock line item for them, not a live animal. So you're gonna run into chance of getting a lot of diseases and stuff like that. The last time I probably bought fish from a Petco was when I was in my early 20s, you know, or not even earlier than that, late teens, you know, whatever. So 20 years plus. I would say stay away from big box stores. Deal with a local pet store that you are familiar with, so you have more of a relationship with them, and you can actually ask them to get you particular types of fish as well. Like, for example, if you're interested in any particular type of fish that you want to get, you can tell the pet store manager that, hey, I want to get these fish. If you have them in the next stock list, can you get them for me? And they would most likely be able to do that for you. So that's something, that's another benefit from dealing with a pet store, as well as they'll give you more information, which correlates to step number one or tip number one. So that's tip number two, I guess, to have a dedicated fish store or a community of people like a fish club that you are a member of, so you can go to the auctions and whatnot and get more information and buy the fish there from a person that has kept them and bred them. So you will know exactly what to do with these fish, and these fish would most likely be more accustomed to living in your own particular water source scenario, like tap or whatever it is. In our case, we get our water from the lake, and our lake water is exactly the same anywhere else in the city. So if I buy a fish that was bred in other parts of the city from a fish club auction, I can very well guarantee that fish is gonna live in my system without an issue, and it's gonna adjust to my water pretty well, because it has been living in the same water for the last its entire life. So that's step number two, I believe. And then the bonus tip I would say is to quarantine your fish when you do get your fish. And this correlates to dealing with a local pet store as opposed to a big box store, because your pet store is more likely going to quarantine their fish more thoroughly compared to a big box store, because your local fish store does not want to have an outbreak, which they cannot afford to have in their facility. So they quarantine everything that comes in for several weeks before they put them out onto the floor. Most of the time, like a lot of the stores I deal with, quarantine their fish for 2 to 6 weeks, and then I get them and I quarantine them again for another 6 weeks before I introduce them to my general population, which seems to really stop diseases from coming into my facility, which stops untimely deaths of fish. For example, all these fish here have been quarantined. I bought most of these fish here, and when I moved them into this tank, they did not bring any disease into this tank, because they all were quarantined for over 6 weeks in a separate quarantine system. So that's tip number three, I believe, because that's very important. So all these tips are pretty much things you can do even before you bring your fish home, and this will really reduce your losses to a large extent. You would probably start seeing majority of the fish you buy living, as opposed to having to go back to the pet store and buy more fish. So that's something to really take into consideration. It's not just the money aspect. These are all living creatures, so you do really want to do your best to minimize loss of life, because everything is a living animal, and a lot of these animals do have extensive knowledge. They're very intelligent. They remember who you are. They, like, especially the ones that live for several years or longer, they remember things. They start following you around when you walk into the room. Once you've had them for a few months or a year, and they've realized that you're not a threat and you are more familiar with them, or they're familiar with you, they start interacting with you. So you don't want to lose them untimely. If you can give them a full long life, that's something you should always strive towards. So that's why I always say, do your best to ensure that you are doing everything in your power to reduce the loss of life. So that's what I'm going to leave you with. And as always, thank you so much for everybody that has subscribed. If you haven't subscribed, please subscribe down below. Hit that notification icon so you get updated when these videos get uploaded. I'm going to make a next one for this series, which is going to be things that you can do in your facility once you have the fish at your facility and you have quarantined them for 6 to 8 weeks and they do not have issues. If you do want me to make a separate video about how to quarantine your fish, please comment below and let me know. And if there's anything else you want to know, please let me know down below. And also, if you guys think my new haircut looks cool or does not look cool, comment down below and let me know. I didn't have a choice. I had to shave my head a couple of times now. I know that's why I haven't been showing my face a few times the last few weeks in the last videos. But since the barber shops are closed, I'm not going to complain about it. I'm going to be a man and I'm going to cut my own hair and do the best I can in the situation that I'm in. So I'm going to leave you with that. And everybody, I hope everybody's staying safe. Thank you so much for subscribing. If you haven't, subscribe down below. We're almost at 500. We want to get to 500 plus subscribers as soon as possible. So that's why I'm always asking you guys to subscribe. So if you haven't subscribed and you're still watching this video, please, please, please subscribe to the channel down below. And hit that notification icon and stay tuned for more videos. As always, I love you all. God bless.